Okay, and here is the approach. It all starts with a so-called fundamental solution of the Laplacian. And in 3D, that's the following function. This function takes a point from R3 and takes 1 over the Euclidean norm of that vector. And of course, to do so, the vector should not be the null vector. It's a simple exercise to check that this function is indeed a harmonic function, so it's subject to the Laplace equation. Okay, everywhere except at the origin, of course. For reasons of normalization, you usually put a factor in front here, which is 1 over 4p, and which is of course not changing this property here. And the 4p has to do with the surface area of the unit ball in 3D. And in fact, for reasons of the right orientation, you also put a minus sign in front. Okay, just for your information, and because we can also depict that in a 3D surface, let me also give you the fundamental solution of the Laplacian in 2D. So in 2D, it's the natural logarithm that solves the Laplacian's equation, and for normalization you divide by 2p, which is the length of the unit circle, the circumference, which is of course the unit ball in 2D. And I'm mentioning this 2D case here just because now I can show you pictures. I can show you the graph of that function. I cannot show you the graph of this function because it would require four dimensions, three dimensions for your variable and one dimension for the value you're computing. But this one can be shown in 3D, and let me try to do so. So here's the graph of the fundamental function in 2D. I can try to move it around. So you can see the singularity at the point zero, where it's, you take the logarithm of something close to zero, that gives you something close to minus infinity. Okay, but then as you go away from the origin, you get this typical logarithm shaped curve here. Okay, so in every other point, it solves the Laplacian equation, Laplace of u equals zero. Well, it's easy to see that you still get a solution of Laplace's equation when you shift your function a little bit to the side. So now you see the singularity at some other point, which is not the origin. But otherwise, the behavior is the same. So all you did is just move your variable x a little bit here. And okay, I mean, you know this from 1D differentiation, whether you first shift your function and then take a derivative, or you first take the derivative and then shift that, you get the same result. Okay, but if the Laplacian gives you zero, then you can shift that around as you want. It stays the zero function. Okay, so both of these functions are solutions of Laplace's equation, and so is every other translate of that first function here. What else can you do? Well, you can translate a solution, you can multiply it by whatever constant you like. And if you have two solutions, you can add them and still get a solution. Let me show you that. So the sum of these two solutions here is the following. So here you see a singularity at the origin and another singularity where this one was. And okay, of course it looks a bit different, but it still solves Laplace's equation because it's the sum of two functions that solve Laplace's equation, and because the Laplace operator is linear. Okay, and in the same style, you can take lots of translates of that original fundamental solution, scale them with whatever coefficients you want, and then superimpose them. So you just take the sum of multiples of translates of this fundamental solution. Okay, so a translate of your fundamental solution is simply this. So you shift the singularity that used to sit at zero to a new point, let's call it x zero. So instead of f of x, you evaluate f at x minus x zero, which of course gives you that expression. And you can plug in every vector from R3, but not x zero because that's just this point of singularity. Okay, this function is often written as a function of x and x0. Let's call that function little k. And now, like I said, you can take a superposition of multiples of translates of f. So you choose many points in your 3D space. Let's call them x1, x2, and so on. And then you translate f into every one of these. Multiply by a scalar of your choice and add everything up, and you still have a solution of Laplace's equation. Of course, now with this many singularities that you all should avoid when choosing your x. And instead of finitely many, you could even take infinitely many, and you could take so many that you cannot use a summation anymore, but instead need an integral. And then it's only up to you to choose the little alphas right in order for your function to also meet this condition here. So you always automatically get a solution for Laplace's equation. You don't have to worry about that condition. All you have to do is to get your little alphas right in order to also make this condition true. Okay, and that's the spirit.